Well, hello, Rockpoint. It is good to be with you today as we talk about the Good Shepherd. Before we jump into our text for today, I want to answer a question that's come up a few times as I've been processing this sermon series with those whom I have been talking to, those who I have been talking to. One of the questions that's come up is the nature of these I am statements. How do they actually work? What's going on here? We say that the Gospel of John is structured around these seven I am statements, but I can say I am in a bunch of different ways. I could say I am Nathaniel. I could say I am a pastor. I am 25 years old, and these kinds of things could be said, but none of them are claims to be Yahweh. But Jesus, when he makes these I am statements, is doing something different. So maybe you remember in Exodus chapter 3, when the Lord is speaking to Moses, he reveals his name to be I am, or Yahweh. If you're ever reading in the Old Testament and you bump into all uppercase Lord, this is the Hebrew word Yahweh, I am, which in Greek turns into ego eimi, which is specifically quoting this. In Greek, you don't have to say ego eimi, however, to say I am. You could basically say that. Jesus does this a bunch of times throughout John's gospel. Unless you believe that I am, you will die in your sins. Before Abraham was, I am. These are also I am statements, though not direct quotations of Exodus chapter 3, like I am the good shepherd. There's also other ways you don't have to say am at all in Greek. Paul says, I am not ashamed of the gospel, and there's no semblance whatsoever to Exodus chapter 3. So all of that is to say, when you look at these seven I am statements that this series is revolving around, these are very unique I am statements, and they're very, very important. So with all of that said, let's jump into our text for today, John chapter 10, verses 11 through 18. And as we flip there, I'd like to just invite us into a conversation where we come to grips with what is a shepherd, actually. We might remember the most famous shepherd from Exodus, or from the scriptures, is probably King David, who was a shepherd before he was king, and then famously prays, perhaps the most famous prayer of the entire Bible, Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd. Now, interesting here, it really isn't that much about caring for sheep when David prays that the Lord is his shepherd. Suddenly, it's a lot more about the humble kind of leadership that the Lord offers God's people who are like sheep. Carrying on with this meaning, Paul uses exactly the same word from Psalm 23, shepherd, in Ephesians chapter 4, when he says there's apostles, there's prophets, there's evangelists, there's shepherds, and there's teachers. That word shepherd is sometimes translated pastor, which is related to the English word pasture. So here we see again, shepherding really isn't just about caring for the sheep. It's actually a lot more about the leadership that Israel, God's people, needs. And we can talk about leadership, we can talk about pastoral care, but we can also talk about these things in the midst of the Old and the New Testament, where there are bad shepherds and there is a leadership crisis. If you look back on Ezekiel 34, and this is just one of many, many, many passages that does this, we see that God is actually frustrated with the bad leaders, these bad shepherds, and they are called shepherds in Ezekiel chapter 34. These are bad shepherds because they feed themselves, not their sheep. They don't strengthen their sheep. They don't search for the lost. They are responsible for scattering the flock, and they're even described as eating God's people. So what is God's solution to this problem in Ezekiel chapter 34? Verse 11, Yahweh proclaims, I myself will search for my sheep and look after them. And now we begin to see that not only is shepherding not just about caring about sheep, it's about leadership, it's about pastoral care, but it's also associated with specific promises from the Old Testament that Yahweh, the great I am, will personally care for his people. And perhaps now when Jesus says, I am the good shepherd, we hear that a little bit differently. There's a lot more context to this. Now, Jesus in his day was dealing with a lot of the same kinds of problems that Ezekiel in his day was dealing with. There was a leadership crisis. The Pharisees, the religious elite, these bad shepherds put Jesus to death for doing good on the Sabbath. That's what has been happening in John's gospel up to this point. He's been healing people. And today, it's much the same. How many leaders are associated with scandal? How many shepherds have stumbled? How many pastors have let the flock that they've been entrusted with down? So with all of this in mind, what does our text have to say? John 10, 11 through 18, and I'm going to read from a slightly different translation just so we hear it a few different ways. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. He who is a hired hand and not a shepherd, who is not the owner of the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and flees, and the wolf snatches them and scatters the flock. He flees because he is a hired hand and does not care about the sheep. I am the good shepherd, and I know my own, and my own know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, I laid down my life for the sheep. And I have other sheep that are not in this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice, and they will become one flock with one shepherd. For this reason, the Father loves me, because I laid down my life so that I may take it back. No one has taken it away from me, but I lay it down on my own. I have authority to lay it down, and I have authority to take it back. This commandment I received from my Father. Now, as I've been looking at this text, I think Jesus is really interested in actually reconstructing some of the ways that we perceive leadership. There's bad leaders out there, and Jesus is interested in addressing this and offering a new kind of leadership. And so, for the rest of this time, I'd like to offer three different things that we see from this text when Jesus identifies himself as, I am the good shepherd. What does this new kind of leadership offer us? How is it different from the leadership of our day? The first way is that the leadership that Jesus offers us is marked by his willingness to die for those he leads. And as I've been thinking about this text, I've been thinking of the story of the three little piggies, each of whom builds a house, one out of straw, one out of sticks, and one out of bricks. And these houses are all meant to stand up against the big bad wolf. Notice there's a big bad wolf in our text as well. And of course, the wolf huffs and he puffs and he can blow the house down made out of straw and out of sticks. But the story takes a turn when he gets to the brick house, because he can huff and he can puff, but it is all for naught. The bricks are strong enough to stand against the wolf. And I think this is kind of how we perceive leadership. We want someone strong enough to stand up against our enemies, to fight against our enemies, to finally have my interests in mind. But notice, this isn't what Jesus offers. He doesn't lead us like this brick house, finally capable of standing against the big bad wolf from verse 12. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. His leadership is marked by his willingness to die for those he leads. He hands himself into the hands of the wolves who seek the sheep, and they devour him. Of course, that's not where the story ends. We know this. Jesus is also the resurrection and the life, which we will talk about very soon. But the point is my power is made great in weakness. The cross isn't about someone who finally has my interests in mind and fights against my enemies. It's about someone who dies for the sheep that he leads. The second way that Jesus offers leadership that is unique from ours is that his leadership is marked by his knowledge of his sheep and their knowledge of him. Verses 14 and 15, I am the good shepherd, and I know my own, and my own know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, I lay down my life for the sheep. We've got a family at West Hills that owns some sheep, and I've really enjoyed hearing some of the stories. To care for this sheep, they actually exit out their front door, and they have to walk around their house to get to the sheep. And what's interesting is that the sheep can identify who's coming by the sound of the footsteps even from the other side of the house. So if the kids are coming, this is great news. Good things are going to happen. We're going to get hugs. We're going to get attention. But if dad is coming, this is not good news. This means that we're going to get sheared. This means the hoops are going to get trimmed and these kinds of things. We do not want that to happen. And the sheep panic. And I don't think we humans are all that different from sheep. I think we're actually quite alike. Since I've gotten married, I've gotten to reflect on some of the liturgies that I had in my home with my parents as I lived in the basement that they no longer have anymore. For example, I would hang out in the basement for hours and hours on end, and apparently I would decide that I have something important to say, and so I would run upstairs, and the sound of my footsteps would be quickly followed by the sound of my voice, which would usually interrupt whatever unimportant things were happening on the other side of that door, even before that door was opened. My family is no longer used to having someone run upstairs and interrupt them, as much at least. Something else I would do, I would make breakfast in the morning, and when I was ready to eat, I would sit at the head of the table and I would grab the chair, scrape it along the floor, and wake everyone up in the entire house. This is not something my family has happening anymore. So much so that chair remains empty when I'm not home. They know I like to sit in that chair. They know the sound of me coming upstairs. They know the sound of me making breakfast. And all of this has contributed to me feeling quite known. But here's the point. We don't all feel that known. And we certainly don't feel it outside of our family units. But don't we long for it? Doesn't it feel special? Don't you want the people in your lives to feel that way? Jesus not only thinks it's possible, but rather because he is the good shepherd, he says that the kind of knowledge where you know Jesus and he knows you is like his own relationship with the Father. This is hard for me to believe. In Christian theology, we worship one God who is united in substance. This is the fancy theology word, but he has three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. This is what we call the Trinity. And so Jesus and the Father are one substance, but two persons. Now, I know what it's like to be a different person from you who is watching, but I don't know what it's like to be the same substance with anybody. So that would be like I had an identical twin who actually shares consciousness and thoughts and hopes and dreams with me, so much so that if I stand here and ask you to, and my identical twin is standing here and ask you, how many people are on screen right now? You would, of course, answer one. That's what it means to share substance with someone. Now, Trinitarian metaphors, they collapse pretty quickly when you think about them too much, so don't think about them too much. But that's the kind of unity that Jesus has with his Father. And he says you can have that kind of unity with him. All you need to do is stop following the leaders of the day. Stop letting yourself be the leader and let Jesus, our good shepherd, lead you. And then you will know God and be known by God. Maybe you've experienced this, maybe you haven't. But this is what Jesus says. You can have this kind of knowledge the same way that shepherds know their sheep, identifying their voices from afar, as in earlier in the text. The same way that sheep can identify their shepherds from around the house before they see them. The same way that Jesus and the Father are one, you can be known by God, identifying his footsteps from around the house and him identifying your house. So I've got a quick reflection question for you to reflect on at home. Do you recognize the sound of Jesus' footsteps in your life? Would he recognize your footsteps? Take a moment and ask the Lord about this. The third way that Jesus' leadership is different from the leadership of our day is that his leadership is marked by his ability to provide unity. This is in verse 16, where Jesus says, "I have other sheep that are not in this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice, and they will become one flock with one shepherd." One flock, one shepherd. This gives me hope because we live in such a divided world. This is actually sometimes listed as one of the most serious problems facing our culture, polarization. I could just start listing topics, and people become very, very nervous and willing to bet if I just name some of them, we'd start zoning back in. We'd also start to get really nervous. And I think this is all evidence of the fact that we are doubtless divided. But not only are we divided, we love being divided. And it doesn't stop out there in the world. It's in this church. It's in our families. And Jesus says that under his shepherding, we will become one flock. Now, this is good news. We can finally experience unity because Jesus is in charge. But notice, there is a condition here in verse 16. This isn't a unity that is achieved through excellent vision or through better theology or through more activism or passion or whatever it is that we might deem necessary to providing unity. It's a unity that Jesus alone has responsibility for, and he achieves it by going out and finding other sheep. Now, I personally tend to think that unity will be realized if we all just stopped believing whatever it is we do believe and believe what I believe, right? And I think we'd get there. We'd get that kind of unity. Once I show up at church alone, though, well, then I might think something has gone wrong. There's a problem. There is no unity found in solitude, and there's even less unity found if that one person is a sinner. Jesus knows this, and his solution to our inability to create unity is found here in verse 16. We will be unified once the good shepherd goes out to find more sheep, not less sheep. And so entirely counter to our intuitions, Jesus envisions unity being conceivably possible only under his leadership and only once all the right people are here. We don't cut those out who disagree with us. Under Jesus' leadership, under his shepherding, our task as Christians is to be ready and hospitable for when the good shepherd invites new sheep into our fold. The reason that we are divided is because there are too few of us to capture the full mosaic of what Jesus is trying to do in this world. Once we're all here, then unity will be restored. We will be one body full of diversity. Isn't this what Paul is talking about in 1 Corinthians when he talks about all being different parts of this one body? Don't we need the other parts? Now, this is all the kind of leadership that Jesus offers us. This is how he shepherds his people. It means that our leader is the one leader who can truly shepherd people. It means that our leader models for us leadership in dying for us, not fighting against our enemies for us. It means that our leader knows us so intimately that there is good news for us who feel alone, that we can finally be known and know our God. It means that we are a part of a people who will provide unity for this broken world, but we don't do this by forcing on ahead. We do this by humbly walking and inviting the lost sheep that Jesus provides for us into our new way of life, our more abundant way of life, from verse 10. So with all of that said, what do we do? What are some practical repercussions of this? I've got three just for me that I think are helpful to think through in light of Jesus being our good shepherd. I'm sure there's more, but these are the three that stick out to me. The first thing as I write this sermon is I personally feel convicted that I'm not naturally attracted to the kind of leadership that Jesus, our great shepherd, offers us. The kind of leadership that doesn't fight for me is not at all exciting. I would way prefer a leader who fights my battles for me. The kind of leadership that spends time with me to get to know me, that seems like a waste of time, which is very precious to us. And not only that, it requires vulnerability, which I'm not profoundly excited to offer people. The kind of leadership that brings more people into my already divided circle of people and influence, that sounds exhausting, but that's the kind of leadership that Jesus offers us. And so I believe the Holy Spirit is convicting me, perhaps you, through this message, that maybe we should spend some time with Jesus repenting, apologizing, getting to know him on a deeper level so that we can become familiar with the kind of leadership that Jesus offers us, the kind of leadership that I so often miss. The second thing for us to take home from this, and this is amid all the change in our world and amid all the change at Rock Point, I remember processing what it meant to be a good shepherd once Dwayne was put on leave, once John was put on leave. But for me at West Hills in particular, thinking through us as a team, who's in charge of what? What do we do? Who provides the leadership? I don't know. And Bow Ridge then has to ask the same kinds of questions. We've had tons of staff who are no longer here that we would love to have here. And so I know Bearspaw has been asking the same kinds of questions. And it's not just staff. It's all of us here at Rock Point. And it's not just Rock Point. It's the church. And it's not just the church. It's the world. We long for good shepherds. And when we lose those, even just for a time, it can become profoundly nerve-wracking. And as I processed my worries and my feelings, I found the Lord drawing me to John chapter 10. Because maybe I had put more importance than I should have on my human leaders. So, what would happen if we all stopped what we were doing, put on hold our expectations, and actually let Jesus offer us the kind of leadership he tells us he does? What is Jesus saying in the midst of this conversation? What is he saying in the midst of this meeting? How would he like to change the trajectory of whatever it is that I am doing right now, this week, today, this month, this year? What if we all sat down and did an inventory of how would Jesus be leading? I promise you, if you invite the Lord into that time, he will speak. He does speak, and he does lead. The third thing as Christians that I'm walking away from this text with is that, of course, Jesus is the good shepherd, but with so many of these I am statements, he says things like, I am the light of the world, but then in the Sermon on the Mount says, you are the light of the world. So he offers us the thing that he is, and we all have leadership. We all offer leadership in our own circle, which really begs the question suddenly, would I die for my friends as they go through their struggles? Am I welcoming new people in? Do I know my friends the way that Jesus knows me? If the answer to any of these is no, then the kind of leadership that I offer in my own little circle is different than the kind of leadership that Jesus, the Good Shepherd, offers us. And thus we should pray that Jesus would make us more like him, that people would see him and his ways through his leadership that we imitate. And so to close, let us remember that Jesus taught us and showed us that he alone is the Good Shepherd. Without his leadership, we all go astray. We all feel lost. We all feel alone. We hurt people, and that so often includes ourselves. And I think if you look back on your life, no matter how long you've walked with Jesus, you will recall ways that you've stepped on people, that I've stepped on people, ways I've been stepped on, ways I've been ignored, misunderstood, done the misunderstanding. The story that Jesus is telling about your life, in your life, doesn't go on that way. He has a better way. He's shown a better way. And so let us remember that we are sheep, beloved and wonderfully made. And as sheep, the wisest, most abundant, most beautiful way to live is to set my understandings and my hopes aside, because only through Jesus and his leadership will we know how to live. He is the Good Shepherd. He has led his people. He is leading us now. And no matter what comes next, he will lead us tomorrow. And so let's close in prayer. Jesus, you are our good shepherd. We shall not want. You make us lie down in green pastures. You lead us beside still waters. You restore our souls. You lead us in right paths for your name's sake. Even though we walk through the darkest valley, we fear no evil, for you are with us. Your rod and your staff, they comfort us. You prepare a table before us in the presence of our enemies. You anoint our heads with oil, our cups overflow. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our lives, and we shall dwell in the house of Jesus, our good shepherd, the whole length of our lives. We love you, Jesus. Give us eyes to see and ears to hear how you are leading us. Amen.